Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
Wonderful. I am sure, and it is evident, that you are really energized by the presence of General Malik, sir, who has commanded the nearly largest armed force in the world. I say nearly because we are not the largest. Million plus army was under the general during the Kargil War. And he is really the Kargil hero. That, friends, there is a lot more that I can say, but I think there's a lot more that the general has to tell us. Sir, may we request you to kindly address the gathering. Thank you very much, friends.
Professor Colonel Balasubramaniam, Brigadier Bambani, Ms. Srivastav, ladies and gentlemen, and dear students, thank you very much for asking me to come here. It's a privilege to be speaking to such a large number of our young people who are going to make better India tomorrow. That's what I believe very strongly. Before I start my lecture, I just want to mention my old association with Brigadier Colonel Balasubramaniam. One day, he came to my office and he said that some students want to come and meet you. And I said, okay. So he brought some students. I'm talking of the time, I think it was 95, that time. And the students said, sir, we are holding a seminar on liberalization. I'm talking of 96. So I said, what do you want me to do? I'm a soldier. I don't know anything about economics. Liberalization was a movement that started. Said, no, but we want you to come. And who was the other person was Ratan Tata. And this seminar was to be held in Bombay. So I said, look, I have no idea. You know, I'm a soldier. Why don't you ask him to speak? So what came out from the students was, sir, we have asked him to speak, but Ratan Tata says, no, he won't speak. He will come, but he won't speak. So I was cornered, literally cornered, to go and to make some kind of introductory remarks, keynote speaker, whatever you like to call it. And I remember of that incident that as soon as I came and sat down, then Ratan Tata asked me, sir, can I speak? I said, my God, it is because of you that I have been roped in, and now you want to speak? Go ahead. And he spoke extempore. And I must say that he spoke very well. I can't forget that incident, because for a soldier, that was my first exposure. Of course, I had to read something. I had to study something before I went for that talk. Well, today, what I am going to talk to you is entirely from my own experience, okay? There are many, many books on leadership and motivation and all. But what I am going to speak to you and what I am going to show you, you will not see it, you will not read it in any other book. And that is the subject of my talk. But before I go, and I think this is important that you all must realize today. You know, I want to tell you what kind of India we are in today and where you have got so many opportunities. I always say that India today is a land of opportunities. We have strong economic fundamentals. There is no doubt about it. And I know it because I am on the board of 6 companies. Earlier we were taking foreign aid, today we are giving foreign aid to many countries. And as you all know, we are the 3rd largest economy in the whole world. The other thing is the democratic institutions. There, that is where we score over China. China doesn't have that kind of democratic institution that we have. And it has a big advantage. It's not just that we are able to say, speak, and whatever, But there are other advantages. The mind is not regimented. The mind is open. That's the best thing about a democratic institution. Educated human resources. One is very proud to see the kind of leapfrog that our children are taking. Everyone, whether they are poor or, you know, everybody is getting an opportunity to study, to read, and to be able to. So that's a great asset that our country has got. Very young age, demographically. As a result, that we've got more and more number of people who will start earning, or who are earning, and who will start earning. Unlike countries like Japan, Spain, Portugal, Italy, where I've seen, you know, the number of young people who are to earn bread, that number is reducing, but the number of people who are dependent on them, older people, that is increasing. Then, of course, economic reforms which have come about and which are still going on, everybody is appreciating it. As far as I am concerned, it's not just about making money, but these reforms are opening our mind. The number of entrepreneurs that you are finding in our country, that number is increasing. The number of opportunities that people are utilizing on their own, that number is increasing. And that's something to be very proud of. And that is why I say that when lives of 1.3 billion people are changing, it's a great opportunity for qualified people as you are going to be today and tomorrow, and day after tomorrow, for you people in India. So our potential requires young leaders. We require young leaders in all professions, not just the army, but every profession that you go into, whether it's corporate or it is government service or wherever. We require good leaders. And my talk today is all about that. As I said, good leaders kaise banoge? Whatever you are studying in addition to that. So let me start off. I have five very simple takes as far as leadership is concerned. The first one is whether you are leading 5 people or 5 million people. The basics, the essentials of leadership, they don't change. I learned as a young officer, even a little earlier after that, before that, and that carried on. And I kept those few principles in my mind, and they were really useful all my life. So the basic essentials don't change. The other thing is a bit of a surprise to, I'm sure it is most of you, that leadership is 20% knowledge. 80% is your attitude, how you conduct yourself with other people. After all, what is required? Requirement is trust. Nobody will follow you unless that person, he or she, trusts you. Am I right? And that trust is not part of your theoretical knowledge anywhere. That trust comes the way you conduct yourself with your colleagues, your friends, your subordinates, your seniors, etc. And that is why I say 80% is that attitude, dealing appropriately with people. Because you have a goal in your mind and you want them who trust you to achieve that goal. The third aspect, there are so many traits that people talk of in leadership. But the most important, I believe, is character. Character is the sum total of good and bad in you. So if there are, if it is 90% good, 10% bad, everyone has some bad aspects also. But if it is 90%, you are good. That's the way to go about. And you've had it if it is less than 50%. So I believe we'll talk about the sound character a little later on also. But that is what is important. That is what creates trust and bonding with each other. Leaders always stand for hope, change, and success. Leaders will never refuse challenges. And quite often, challenges will produce good leaders whom you do not know. There is a symbiotic relationship between leadership and challenges. So never ever refuse challenges. You will always need to take it head on. And last, but perhaps the most important, and this is again personal experience, I say that leaders are not born, maybe seldom. You see, most of the people who want to be leaders in political life, just because they are born, I don't think we want to call them leaders yet. They have to prove themselves. So I don't believe that leaders are born. Leaders are a result of hard work. Leaders are a result of self-belief, believing in yourself. The opportunities they manage to get, everyone doesn't get opportunities. If you are lucky, you will get more opportunities. But opportunities are there in everyone's life. And last but not the least is that making use of those opportunities to become leaders, that experience that counts. Once you have gone through an experience, and that is where experience becomes quite important to become leaders. Now, out of the traits, I just want to talk about five of them. First, of course, is that you must be clear about your vision, your laksh, aim, what you want to be. What you want to be. And it doesn't have to be throughout the life. Laksh and aim will keep on changing depending upon the situation in which you are placed. But you must be quite focused on that, that this is what I want to be or I want to do. Coming to character, ethics, and values, I just give you four of them. The first one is discipline. Now, please don't misunderstand discipline to be standing to Savdhan, saluting, or, you know, doing what right turn, etc., like you find in the army. Discipline basically is doing things sequentially in a manner that you don't waste time and you don't waste energy. You go through a sequence. That is discipline. At home also, whatever you are doing, if you do those things sequentially, you don't waste time. You don't come in the way of others. You go through. Let me give an example of a crossing. When you are driving, you go through a crossing. If there is a red light, you don't stop. And you try to run, you make yourself miserable and you also make others' life miserable. So that is discipline, doing things in a sequential manner. Then everybody takes advantage, makes use of that. Integrity is very important. And here, integrity, a leader has to be transparent. Because unless people know what kind of a personality or transparent person you are, they will not follow you. I just want to give an example. When I became chief, I felt that as a chief, I should not be taking any gift from anybody. I remember it was Diwali, and somebody brought a tray with the liquor and kajus and God knows what all, you know. And I had said that I will not accept it, just when I was becoming a chief. And yet somebody had done it. So what I did next day, I got those things packed, I sent it back to that same officer, and a letter which I wrote, don't do it again. And I kept that letter open because I wanted everyone to see that. My ADC took that open letter along with that and he took it to that officer. That officer's staff also saw that and then they all realized that this is what he means business. He will don't do it again. And I wanted everyone to see that. I mean, everyone got to know about it because people started talking among themselves. Okay, look, this is what he has done. So you have to be transparent and you have to convey to people that, look, this is what is required. I'll talk a little more about the integrity part later. Team spirit, as you were seeing that clip earlier, that is, that time also I said that nobody can win a battle alone. Similarly, you can't achieve anything for your organization alone. You have to be a part of a team, and you have to first learn to be a good member of a team before you start leading the team. If you're not a good member of a team, you can't lead a good team. Please remember that. And of course, dedication and duty, this is what I meant by hard work. And that comes when you do things when nobody else is watching you. And ethics and values are always important, individually as well as organizationally. I learned what is written here when I was in the Indian Military Academy. And even as an army chief, I had those lines written down in front of my table, also in the visitor's room, so that everybody knew that this is what I believe in. These are my ethics and values. And those are the safety, honor, and welfare of your country come first, always, and every time. The honor, welfare, and comfort of the men you command come next. And your own ease, comfort, and safety come last, always and every time. How many of you think of your driver when you are moving around to see whether that driver has had food or not? That's an important aspect. So all these things must be kept in mind, particularly about the subordinates. Practicing ethics and values is necessary. If you look at all the organizations, the corporate houses, you can grade them because of the ethics and values they have practiced over the years. 150 years old companies, 200 years old companies. Tatas today are known, well known. Why? They're one of the oldest companies. Because of ethics and values. The day they go wrong, their name will be in mud, or anybody. So this is important both individually as well as a corporate house. 20% knowledge. So this is what I believe in, that you have to keep yourself updated in whatever profession you are doing. Wherever you go, you must keep yourself updated on that. It's not just the business spy, but even somebody's an engineer, he has to be, somebody's into IT, they have to remain updated on things that are happening. Similarly, somebody in the army, he or she also has to keep updated this thing. And as Bhagavad Gita itself says, on earth there is no purifier as great as knowledge. So when I say 20%, it doesn't mean that knowledge is not important. Knowledge is important, and you must keep yourself abreast of whatever is happening. Now I'll talk to you some of the things that in practice, what I practice or what I have felt that those are important aspects when it comes to practicing leadership. And the first thing I believe, you have to be action-oriented. I have always liked that Nike slogan, which said action, isn't it? Action is more important than knowledge. And even Bhagavad Gita says that all actions without exception culminate in knowledge. When you have gone through action, there is knowledge that you have gained, the experience that you have gained. Knowledge and action both lead to supreme bliss. This is what our Bhagavad Gita says. However, action is superior to knowledge. So remember, just reading books or knowing theory is not good enough unless you have practiced it. Action becomes more important. Never hesitate from action. Action is making use of the opportunity that you get and experience that you gain out of that. And there are some actions which will take long. There are some actions which will, immediately you will see the result. But you have to be resilient. You have to be you can be patient, but don't give up early. When you are doing a particular thing, don't give up soon. See it through. Test of a policy. Yeah, this is important. It is not how it begins, but how it ends. When Kargil War started, everyone had long faces. Even I had, I was wondering, kya hoga? But it was not that beginning, it is the end that, you know. So end of a policy is more important than the beginning. Some people in India think that humne policy bana diya, we have made a plan and my job is done. I don't believe that is correct. You have to see it through. You have to see it through and make sure that it is you succeed in that. So it's the end which is important. Now, communication is very important today. And I'm so glad to see that many of our schools, colleges are now training children how to communicate. Please remember, communication is not just language that you speak. Communication is much more than that. Communication involves your body language. Communication involves your expressions. Communication involves being able to come across as a very sincere person. All that is part of communication. This photograph that I have shown is of Field Marshal Manekshaw speaking to a jawan. The first thing that you need to notice is, look at the eye contact. If you do not have an eye contact with the person that you are speaking, you cannot be coming, you will not come across as a very sincere person. That becomes important. So all these aspects go into communication, and there is a quote from Sun Tzu, his book, The Art of War, which says, if words of command are not clear and distinct, if orders are not thoroughly understood, who's to blame? The general is to blame. The leader is to blame. So your communication has to be absolutely right. I now go to some aspects of teamwork. Be a good team member before you become a good team leader. And the first thing is, you have to remember that in any organization, there are different people, different doing different jobs in any organization. In the army, we have the infantry, armored corps, you have artillery, you have the service corps, ordnance, AME, medical corps, so many of them. And ultimately, what you have to do is you have to synchronize their activities in a manner that you deliver what is required on the front. The man who is fighting, he gets whatever he needs. Everybody is supporting. So it's a teamwork that works. Like an orchestra, you have 110 pieces in an orchestra. If two of them are not playing the correct tune, as indicated by the conductor, the orchestra will not sound good. But if everyone with different instruments, musical instruments, they're all playing in a synergized manner, the way they have been, you will have very fine music. So teamwork really is an orchestra which requires good collaboration and harmony with each other. Then there is always a problem at the higher level, not being sure of whether it is going to, you know, you're never sure of all your things. What we call the fog of war. There is always a fog of war. People will say, nahi, aisa nahi hona chahiye, aisa hona chahiye. Somebody will say, aisa nahi, aisa. Phir aapko pata nahi hai, ye yahan par kya ho raha hai. All that will go on when you're taking a decision. What we call the fog of war. But as a leader, you cannot be seen as somebody who is not sure of himself. You have to be seen as somebody who will make up his mind and then he knows he's sure of it. We had a big problem initially during Kargil War that
all our intelligence agencies said that these people who have come from across, they are all militants, jihadis. But I was a little doubtful, and there were some other people also who were doubtful. So utterly shelling kaise ho rahi hai, ye kaise ho rahi hai. Suddenly, guerrillas will run away after firing a few shots. But these shots were sitting there. They were not moving, they were not going. So I had to give orders. I said, look, I want clear proof of who these people are. And I don't mind even if we lose a few people, but I want exactly the detail. Within a few days, I got that answer. And we then were able to tell the government that these are not jihadis. These are Pakistan army people. So we have to fight as if we are fighting the, you know, the rules of engagement against the militants are quite different to rules of engagement when you are fighting another army. So we were sure, I mean, that fog of war, because there, it took us a few days, but once it was clear, then we knew what to do, and we handled it that way. Stay calm under pressure, like the pilot in a storm. I don't know how many of you have heard this. Sullenberger, one of the U.S. airlines, I think it's U.S. Air pilot, as soon as he took off from the airfield in New York, the geese went into both the engines, and both engines stopped within a few minutes. This man, he did not tell people, but he knew that now both engines have stopped. So he told, he said, don't worry, we are going to land now. And do you know that he landed that whole aircraft with about 150 passengers in Hudson River in New York. Not a single person was hurt. Everyone was evacuated. But the calmness that he showed was exemplary. I don't think I have come across a person who can be as calm as him. Now there's a picture, I don't know whether it's come to India properly, not yet.
Kali.
It's becoming Sally something.
Kali.
Yeah. But I think that's the best example I can give of remaining calm. As a young officer, even as a colonel or brigadier, I used to get angry. But you know what I did? I put a small chit on my table under the glass. I said, stay calm. That reminded me that, look, you don't get angry unless sometimes you want to be, you want to show your anger. That's a different matter. But otherwise, you should not, because anger means not being rational. Anger takes away rationality from you. Now, visiting the ground becomes important. You know, a lot of people these days, very comfortable offices in Bombay, or even Pune, wherever they are, they all think giving orders or speaking on the phone, the smartphone, sometimes video, audio, AVQ. But nothing like going to the ground. And therefore, wherever you expect some crisis to take place, our crisis is taking place, you must go and visit that place. During Kargil War, I had nothing to do with fighting. My fighting part was strategy in Delhi. There were these brigades and divisions that were fighting. But I went every sixth day to find out the Kyaudama. So that becomes important. That's why I always say, never hesitate to visit where the action is or is likely to be. And what is very important with many of our very senior corporate executives, don't realize that the person who gets the money for the company is not somebody who is sitting in Bombay or Delhi or something. It is the person who is ultimately selling it to the person. If you are, say, whether it is any company, a tire manufacturer, ultimately who gets the money for the tire manufacturer? The person who is selling the tire to people. So that is a person important, and therefore it is always important for everybody to know how that thing is. How the tires are being sold, not sold, what is the problem? We see that every few days. I mean, I used to discuss it more and connect and share ideas with your team and clients in the field. Because if you go to the field, then you will be able to share your ideas. A visit to the ground is equal to 1,000 on the map. This is what the army teaches us. Right from the beginning, we tell that a visit to the ground is equal to 1,000 visits on the map. That is why it becomes important. Collaboration has become important today. You know, not you can't work in silos. You have to interact with people. Whatever decisions are taken, whatever actions are required on the ground, you have to interact with people. So don't become so introvert that you are not interacting with people. Don't work in silos. One of the biggest problems that our government of India has, and I'm sharing with you, is because our ministries tend to work in silence. And finally, when things start happening on the ground, then you realize, oh, uske saath mein to bataya nahi tha. We did not collaborate, so on. And then the problems are there. So collaboration is becoming more and more important, and particularly with the kind of connectivity that we have now developed. And so therefore, I always believe that you should never hesitate in talking to people either vertically or laterally. You must get to know as many people as possible. And this whole cabin mentality, isolating yourself. You know, I get very upset when people are wishing each other good morning, not speaking to each other, but over the internet or on the SMS or on the WhatsApp and all that, good morning. I mean, they think that their work is done. But unless you go and meet each other, you will not get to know the person. Empowerment, delegation of responsibility, one has to be very clear that the job of a senior person is to create an atmosphere in which the junior can do what the senior wants. And as far as the juniors are concerned, their job is to do it on the ground. And if there's a difficulty, he tells the senior, hey, look, this is the problem. So our job has to be very clear. The junior has to understand what kind of orders I am being given. And the senior has to understand that I have to create a conducive atmosphere where the junior has no problem at all. And but then it doesn't mean that the senior should not be watching or should not be monitoring. They have to monitor on the ground. That's what I told you, that during the Kargil War, every sixth day I was on the ground. And what was I asking? Theek hai, kuch chahiye, aapko koi takleef hai, ghar se chitti aati hai ki nahi, khana mil raha hai ki nahi. That's all that I did. The fighting part was done by the soldiers and the other ground officers who were there. Stay trusted and accessible to your colleagues. You know, leaders are meant to solve problems. And the day your colleagues stop bringing their problems to you is the day you have stopped leading them. So everybody says every day it is all right, fine, everything. As they don't come to you, you should start wondering, kya baat kya hai? Why? Everything cannot be hunky-dory every day for, you know, continuously. So that is an important aspect. And one of the last ones that I will mention is create a balance in your personal life and professional world, and remain a moderate person. You know, these extreme views, they don't really pay you. And I have asked for some time, written something, enjoy your professional work, find time for your hobby and enjoyment, always take care of your health. Be smart, dress appropriately. You don't have to be a hero from the films to be able to impress people. And I'm so glad to see the way everybody is dressed here. And I think that is the correct way. That is how all executives should be dressed. Never neglect your family and friends. And do not become a slave to your mobile phone. So many times I find when we are talking to each other, people are on the Twitter. I have to tell them, stop doing that. Listen to me. No, that kind of an attitude is not right. And as far as the motivation is concerned, again, it's an important aspect that leadership, motivation go together. Motivation is an essential aspect of leadership. And you should be able to motivate. And I've given these photographs because you'd be surprised that motivation can make a person do much more than 100%. I have seen people, once they are motivated, they will go out of their way to do things, something you don't expect. They will do it. Some person in a section or a platoon, I mean, you may be wondering, ordinary, but when the opportunity comes, this man will jump and he will do something totally, you know, which can be a battle-winning. But that is all because of motivation. So motivation is important, and you can't keep a person motivated at a very high level all the time. You have to be very careful how you motivate people. In a crisis, you can motivate people. But when there is no crisis, then let them relax also. Then don't get them charged always. So that aspect has to be remembered. And last advice of mine is achievements in life can be a hereditary. You know, in the army, a person when he becomes a lieutenant colonel, a colonel these days, he starts commanding a battalion of about 750 people. Now, 750 people who are under his command is a great feeling. If you say Savdhan, 750 people stand to Savdhan. You know, you can make them do, because that is the kind of organization we are. So my advice to all those young officers who become colonels, is always, I should write to them that command or that kind of leadership is a heady one. If you sip it slowly, you will enjoy that wine. If you try and drink it fast, it will go to your head and you will fall flat on your nose and you will destroy everything that you have got. So always keep your feet on the ground. However high you may go, don't let that thing go to your head. Simple, but I think it's very important.
Hi, Madhugar, student manager of Sri Balaji Society, is honored and privileged to get an opportunity to propose a vote of thanks to on this historic occasion. General V P Malik, sir, we are greatly encouraged by your gracious presence, and your inspiring address has immensely benefited us a lot. It is our vision and leadership that has brought many revolutionary changes in the army. Sir, we assure you to work on the given direction of honesty, courage, and determination. I convey my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Ranjana Malik, directors, faculty members, distinguished participants, student managers, and especially our beloved Bala sir, who gave us this opportunity to interact with such a dynamic personality. We are looking forward for more frequent interactions with you on and off the campus. Thank you, sir, and thank you.